The church say amen again.
Amen.
I want to thank Sister Joletta for that song. It really brings home to the heart how I feel when I stand up here. It's very mixed feelings because it's a weight to have to bear the word of God at this time in Earth's history. And as the disciples said, who is sufficient for these things? I have lived the life of selfishness, rebellion against God, and even to this day, I cannot stand before you and say I appreciate all his goodness towards me to the degree that I ought to. And it's always hard to stand up here because you feel your own sense of unworthiness. But as the song said, through it all, we learn to trust God. Amen. I would ask my wife, do you have the puzzles there? Or who has them? The deacons have them. The children raise their hands so they can receive their puzzles. If we have any children who are here for the first time, you'll notice that the words of the puzzle are not on the page, except for on the bottom of the page that you can start with. But you'll have to watch the presentation, and as I go through the presentation, I'll reveal the words through the word search. And we want to make sure that all the children get a copy, so only after the children have gotten theirs can the adults have some. But we want to keep back a few extra just in case some children show up at the end. As when I do my presentations now, I like to keep the congregation engaged. And so can I get a volunteer to carry a mic? Okay, Elder Bain will carry the mic. I'm going to read a statement while they're passing those out. This is from First Volume of the Testimonies, 129. Paragraph 1. It says, I saw that God has given his servants the truth so clear, so plain, that it cannot be resisted. Wherever they go, they have certain victory. Their enemies cannot get around the convincing truth. Light has been shed so clear that the servants of God can stand up anywhere and let truth, clear and connected, bear away the victory. This great blessing has not been prized or even realized. The prophet tells us that we can stand up anywhere and let truth, clear and connected, bear away the victory. This is not talking about debate or argument. It's talking about simply giving the truth in a clear and connected way, and it will bear away the victory. It doesn't mean that the soul will be won. It just means that the truth will bear away the victory. But when I read this statement a few years ago, it inspired me to start studying from the Bible with a certain method. And that method was to trace the development of things from Genesis to the end. Because everything is a development. The natural world, whether it's going to be a wheat, meaning righteousness, or a tare, meaning unrighteousness, things grow in a gradual way. And so I begin to study all the topics that we have, starting with Genesis and moving through Revelation. So as you see on the screen, the title of this message is Thy Seed and Her Seed. And it says part two, but this is an unofficial part two because I didn't finish part one, so I had to extend it to a part two. The actual part two was supposed to take us down to our time, and I'm not going to get a chance to do that today, of course, and I don't know when the next time I'm going to be speaking. It may be a while, so we may continue this, or you may have to wait for another time when I put it on a CD or a DVD. But the crux of it is, looking at the development of the character of Christ and the character of Antichrist to their ultimate fulfillment. Amen? Now we're going to do a short review and then we'll continue on. And because this is, as I said, an unofficial part two, I'll probably touch on some things I might not have had we not had this part two. I'm trying to get away, or the Lord is impressing me and leading me away from simply giving information, but to more give empowerment. Because information is just information. So as we go through, we may make little pit stops and talk about the different beliefs that are out there in the world and how you can use the truth that we have to meet those. Again, you may not win the soul, but the truth will bear away the victory. And so we'll make little pit stops and we'll study things along the way that we're going to touch upon that we wouldn't have had time to do had we not had this part two. Amen? So I'm going to say another word of prayer. Kneel if you can, or just bow your heads. Heavenly Father, it is by the merits of your Son, Jesus Christ, Lord of all and Savior of humanity, that we do humble ourselves before you. And Father, again, I want to thank you for sparing my life and the lives of my brothers and sisters who are gathered here. We know that you saw this moment even from the foundation of the world, and that you heard this prayer also, Lord, and that you had already prepared providence to answer it. And so we ask now, Lord, that you will grant us your Holy Spirit, that angels that excel in strength will be in our midst to fight unseen battles, Lord, and that this truth may take root in our heart and even bear a harvest unto eternal life. Give us an understanding of the development of your character in the world and the character of the Antichrist. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. All right, our scripture reading came from Genesis 3:15. We're gonna add verse 14 as we go through our review. While we're doing this review, I'll probably just go over the scripture so we can move very quickly and get to where we need to be. Now, Brother David Smith, who is in the back, he works the audio visual. He says he has copies of part one for anybody who wants it. So if you want it, please see David Smith in the back of the sanctuary. All right, so turn to Genesis chapter 3. We're going to look at verse 14 and 15 really quick. Genesis 3, 14 and 15. And I believe I remember this, so I'll just say it. And the Lord God said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, cursed art thou above all cattle and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. And I will put what? Enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Now, does anybody remember what we what enmity was? Hostility. It was hatred. It was hatred with expression. Hatred with expression. Not hatred that can be masked in any way. It's hatred that is hostile. Amen? Now, what were the three main elements in this scripture? The woman, her seed, seed, and the serpent. And we connected that to what? Revelation chapter 12. So turn there real quick. Revelation chapter 12. Revelation chapter 12. We're going to look at verses 1 through 5. Revelation chapter 12, 1 through 5. And there appeared another wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. And she being with what? Now, child. I didn't ask this question, but I asked it the last time. What does she represent? Children. So there's a woman, and she is with child. Correct? She being with child, travailing in birth, and pain to be delivered. And there appeared another wonder in heaven. Behold, a great red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his head. And his tail did what? It drew a third part of the stars of heaven and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born. And she brought forth a man-child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron, and her child was caught up unto God and to his throne. Now drop down to verse 17. And the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Now, are there any words in here that represent enmity or hostility? Devoured and wroth. Now, what about the woman and the sea toward the dragon? Were there any words that depicted hostility from the woman or the sea toward the dragon? Say what? Keep the commandments. I think y'all speaking from understanding and not so much from what's actually in the text. That was for the dragon toward the woman. Was there any? There's really no words there that show any hostility from the woman or the sea toward the dragon. There's not. Now, we didn't say this last time, but is the seed of the serpent represented in this chapter at all? Just from your knowledge of the chapter. From your knowledge of the chapter. 12. Yes. It is, right? It's not on the surface, but we know that Satan does not do his bidding in person. And so the ultimate fulfillment of the Antichrist is who or what? No, I want a plain, earthly, who is the Antichrist? The papacy. The papacy. Now, what in this chapter alludes us toward the papacy? Seven heads and ten horns. There's something a little bit more direct. Persecution, yes. There's something even more direct. No, the papacy wasn't around at that time. We didn't read the verse. Let me give you that clue. We didn't actually read the verse. I said from your knowledge of the chapter. Verse 14? 13? Somebody said 13. Somebody said 14. All right, get that mic. All right, who says 13? Okay, Denise, why do you say verse 13? We can't hear you. Okay.
Okay. So when it says here, it says when the dragon saw that he was cast into the earth, well, we knew who the dragon is, he persecuted the woman which brought forth the man child. Well, I don't know now.
Okay, it's not 13. It's not 13. We had a 14 over here, right next to her.
Yeah, I say it's verse 14 because 13, just to say that he persecuted a woman, he's been persecuting the church from the Garden of Eden, so mm-hmm. You can't really lock down on the papacy, but this time, times and half a time, that's a specific
that's
time
specific
reference
to, that, the that to the papacy. That's the specific fulfillment of thy seed. They're both seeds are actually represented in this chapter. Amen? Did everybody get that? It was the time period that was given both in verse 6 and in verse 14. The seed of the serpent. The ultimate fulfillment of the seed of the serpent was Antichrist, which we said was the papacy. The papacy reigned for 1,260 years. That time period is given twice in the Bible. So the seed is represented here in Revelation 12. Amen? For the children, the first two words are serpent and enmity. Serpent and enmity. All right, we've already covered this. Her seed ultimately represents Christ, correct? Which means the serpent seed would ultimately represent Antichrist. Antichrist. The next word is Christ. All right, this is from part one. The only way children come into the world is through a woman. So when it says thy seed in Genesis 3:15, in reference to the serpent, the seed must also come through the woman. Satan was not going to be able to have his own children on earth. So this one woman was going to have to give birth to both seeds. Both seeds. The woman in Revelation 12 represents the church, illustrating that the serpent seed, Antichrist, would come out of the church. Or the woman. And we had scriptures that we covered in part one. Get the CD from Brother David, and you'll find it there. The goal of our study was to examine the development of the characters of these two seeds from the beginning of time, starting with who?
Cain.
And Abel. The very next chapter gives you the development of this prophecy. It wastes no time at all. Right from the beginning, God gives us this prophecy, and right after that, we see two seeds come from one woman, and they each have one character of Christ, one character of the serpent. All right? We're not going to read Genesis 4, 1 through 8, but in verses 5 and 6, we read that Cain was wroth, reflecting the attributes of the dragon or the serpent in Revelation 12. He was wroth because his sacrifice was not accepted. We noted that the enmity or hostility is expressed by the serpent and his seed through violence. Through violence. That's how the enmity is expressed. We also noted that Christ and his followers do not have emotional hatred for the wicked. That is not how our hatred or enmity is expressed. The enmity they express is by obedience to God's commandments while not participating in or condoning the rebellious lifestyle of the wicked. And that to them is a show of hatred. And we use the example of the homosexual movement that's going on right now, because if you will not accept that this is an acceptable lifestyle, you are accused of having hate, even though you have none. And so now we're starting in our day to see the final fruition of this enmity and a polarization that's going to end with God's people being persecuted and violence coming back to the surface. And remember, this study comes on the backdrop of the overcoming sin. And we said that after we reach the point where Satan cannot do anything and he finds nothing in us, he's going to stir up the wicked powers of the earth to do something to you. And that's the development of this enmity pronounced in Genesis 3:15. Now, why did Cain slay Abel? His works were righteous, and Cain's works were evil, and his brother's righteous. And after it says that in 1 John chapter 3, verse 12, verse 13 says, "Marvel not if the world hate you." And so John is telling us this story that we see with Cain and Abel is just an expression or an illustration of what's going to happen on a worldwide scale in your day. In your day. Amen? The next two words are Cain and Abel. Cain and Abel. All right, now, get ready, the mic. Now we're going to go on and continue. We're going to pick up sort of where we left off, because I left out a few things because of time. Now, can somebody tell me what the word Genesis means? Beginnings, right? So everything in Genesis is giving us the beginning of things. It is the seed from which everything else is going to spring from and grow. Now, can somebody read for me Genesis 4, 17, 20 through 22? We read this in part one, but we're going to read it again. Okay, Sharon Francis, right here, next to Chandra.
And Cain knew his wife, and she conceived and bare Enoch. And he builded a city and called the name of the city after the name of his son Enoch. And Ada bare Jabal. He was the father of such as dwell in tents, and of such as have cattle. And his brother's name was Jubal. He was the father of all such as handle the harp and organ. And Zillah, she also bare Tubal Cain, an instructor of every artificer in brass and iron, and the sister of Tubal Cain was Naamah.
Okay. All right. Now remember, these children that were born to who?
Cain.
But specifically, No. Say what? Lamech. What did Lamech do? He killed the man. What did he do before that? He married two wives. Now, in the natural world, what spreads and grows faster, good seed or bad seed? Weeds, right? And we said in part one that in the spiritual world, as well as in the physical world, good seed needs a certain environment for it to grow. We see in the sons of Jacob, even though he was a righteous man, he had all those wives, and what was his children like? They were a mess, correct? In order to raise up righteous seed, it must be in a certain environment, one man, one woman, and then the children. But wickedness can take as many wives as they want, have as many children as they want, and they'll turn out wicked. And so wickedness will always spread faster than righteousness. It will always. It does in your garden, in your lands, but it also does in the spiritual realm. But we said, what does the words father and instructor in connection with the children of Lamech, born under polygamy, imply in verses 20 to 22? They were first, which also relates to the word Genesis, does it not? They were the father or the beginning of certain things. And we asked the question before, how could they do this above the righteous? Because the things that they were doing were not actually necessarily evil, were they? They were the father of certain things, but these things weren't necessarily evil. And here we have this statement from Great Controversy 88. It says, Satan has control of all whom God does not especially guard. He will favor and prosper some in order to further his own designs. Now, remember the question we also asked in part one. Let's take the example of music. Is there satanic music on earth today? Satan uses that to draw people away, does he not? Is that something that Satan used in heaven?
No.
Genesis is showing us how Satan began to develop his plans in a new battlefield. From way back in Genesis chapter 4, Satan was already learning new strategies. He could not use the same tactics in heaven that he learned to use on earth. Everything he did in heaven was stealth. But on earth, he began to use and develop new tactics. By the time he got to after the flood, it was perfected. But we're going to see how he began and how these same things are being used today. All right? And we also looked at the scripture in Luke 16:8. Remember that the children of the world are in their generation wiser than the children of light. And it doesn't necessarily mean that they are wiser, but it means that they're better at being dark than the children of light are at being light. They're better at being unrighteous than we are at being righteous. And that's what was going on from the beginning. It says, why would God not allow his children to accomplish these things first? Why would God not allow us or his children to accomplish these things first? Now, I'll ask another question. Is a knife a good thing or a bad thing? It depends on the use, correct? So, at what point do you give your child a knife? When they're able to use it without harming themselves, correct? So if God would allow the wicked to do these things, before he allowed his children to accomplish them, he obviously saw that there was a way to use these things that could be harmful, and he withheld them for their good. Amen? Now, one of the things was city. The first thing that Cain did when he left was he went and he built a city. Now, let me call on some people. Sister Rose, could you get Genesis 11:4 for me? I'm saying that city is the beginning of architecture and monuments and memorials. This is where it began.
Genesis 11:4. And yes. They said,
"Go to, let us build us a city and a tower, whose top may reach unto heaven, and let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth."
All right. So he started this in Genesis chapter 4 with the first city, but we see that cities later became a way for people to make a name for themselves. And monuments and memorials came from the building of cities. Cattle became the beginning of commerce. Sister Mashburn, could you read Genesis 13 and verse 4? Cattle became the beginning of commerce, the economy as we know it today.
Unto the place of the altar which he had made there at the first, and there Abram called on the name of the Lord. Is that
13? Is that right?
Yeah, that's right.
Genesis 13, 4?
Uh-huh.
Maybe I had the wrong verse. Verse 5. Verse 2. I'm sorry. Read verse 2.
And Abram was very rich in cattle and silver and in gold.
He was very rich in what? Cattle. So cattle was what became the beginning of commerce. What about instruments? Instruments were the beginning of entertainment. Chandra, could you read Ezekiel 33, 31, and 32? Ezekiel 33, 31, and 32. Brother Fred, could you get Judges 4:3 for me?
You ready?
Yes.
And they come unto thee as the people cometh, and they sit before thee as my people, and they hear thy words, but they will not do them. For with their mouth they show much love, but their heart goeth after their covetousness. And lo, thou art unto them as a very lovely song, one of one that hath a pleasant voice and can play well on an instrument. For they hear thy words, but they do not them, but they do them not. And when this cometh to pass, lo, it will come, then shall they know that a prophet hath been among them.
All right, so here the Lord compares people who come in to sit before the prophet as those who come to sit before those who have a musical voice and play well on an instrument. It causes people to come and sit and be entertained. Be entertained. And remember, this is the development in Genesis 4, but I said the method of my study now is to go from Genesis all the way down to our time. And you'll see that these four things are the very things that we're up against today in their perfection. All right, iron and brass were the beginning of mechanics and weapons. As a matter of fact, it said he was an artificer of iron and brass. If you look up that word artificer, it actually means mechanic. Mechanic. So iron and brass was the beginning of mechanics and weapons. Somebody read, Fred, Judges 4:3.
And the children of Israel cried unto the Lord, for he had 900 chariots of iron, and 20 years he mightily oppressed the children of Israel.
Amen. So you see what they begin to make out of iron, weapons and chariots. So this was the beginning of the mechanics and the military instruments and vehicles and such as tanks and so on and so forth is what it became. But this was the beginning of it. For the children, the next two words are father and beginning. Father and beginning. Now, we talked about Genesis chapter 5, and Genesis chapter 5 was a chronology of God's seed. And in that chapter, we see the reward of the righteous because it tells us that Enoch was taken from earth. So while God is showing in Genesis chapter 4 that the seed of the serpent began to have earthly blessings, he showed what the reward of the righteous was through Enoch. Through Enoch. Now, here's a statement on the bottom I want you to pay attention to. Genesis chapter 5 is somewhat of an interlude between chapter 4 and 6, whereas chapter 6 is the continuation of chapter 4. You understand what I'm saying? Genesis chapter 5 is an interlude. It's just giving you the chronology of who was born, the genealogy of Christ, if you will. But really, chapter 6 and chapter 4 should be studied one after the other. And these things that were mentioned here played a very big part in what we're going to read when we get to chapter 6. So turn to Genesis chapter 6. Read verses 1 and 2. Roy, since you're there, read verses 1 and 2.
And it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose.
All right. Now, who are the sons of God? Hand? What'd you say? The righteous seed. Now, is that what everyone believes? Satan's kids. Seth's kids. Okay, Seth's kids. Now, has anybody heard of any alternative beliefs to that? Okay, we got a hand over here.
I've heard that the people think that is the mingling of angels with men that are the seed.
Amen. And there's quite a few even honest Christians who believe that. Now, do you know how to refute that from the Bible? Do you know why they believe that? Giants. Okay, anything else? Turn to Job. Job 1:6. We'll only read one of these scriptures. Akilah, since you have the mic, read Job 1:6. And when somebody believes something, I do try to not just ridicule their belief, but you want to see why they believe it. And they believe that the scriptures actually support that these were angels. But let's look at the scripture carefully. Go ahead.
Okay, Job 1, verse 6. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them.
Okay. Now we have a meeting of the sons of God with the Lord, and then Satan shows up among them. Now Satan's real name is, or his first name was what?
Lucifer.
And Lucifer was what? He was an angel. So they are now deducting that since the sons of God came together and Lucifer, an angel, came among them, that all the sons of God must be angels. But is that what the verse says? Now, if you read the verse after that, the Lord is surprised that Lucifer is even there. Not that he's surprised, but he says, like, what are you doing here, basically? Now, so but is it a reasonable deduction? On the surface, it's a reasonable deduction. They have no knowledge of unfallen worlds. They have no knowledge that there's a representative for each unfallen world. And so they automatically think that because Lucifer is an angel, the sons of God are angels. Go ahead. Wait for the mic.
Throughout the New Testament, we are called the sons of God, and we're certainly not angels.
Exactly.
So that only holds water, like if you think about it for a second. Beyond that, it loses all credibility.
And we're going to go back to Genesis 6 in a minute after we go through some scriptures in the New Testament, and we're going to show who the sons of God are. So, let's see.
But because after you read further on in Job, it tells you why Satan was there and who he was representing.
Yeah.
So that explains also.
All right.
Who are the sons of God?
I see I need some volunteers. Lucille, could you get for me Luke 1? After that, Jenny, could you get Romans 9? And we'll just paraphrase John 8. Luke 1, 34 and 35. And then you're going to go to chapter 3 after that. So Luke 1, 34 and 35. And then you're going to go to chapter 3.
Luke 1, 34 and 35. Then said Mary unto the angel, how shall this be, seeing I know not a man? And the angel answered and said unto her, the Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore, also the holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God.
Okay, so this is the story of Christ. Keep it, Lucille. You're going to go to chapter 3. This is the story about Christ being born. And it says, that thing that shall be born of thee shall be called what? The Son of God. But how was that thing going to be born unto her? Say it louder. The Holy Ghost was going to come upon her. Keep that in mind. Go to Luke chapter 3 and read verse 38, Lucille.
Verse 38. Which was the son of Enos, which was the son of Seth, which was the son of Adam, which was the son of God.
Okay, so now we establish that Adam was called the son of God when he was created in his image, his perfection. You can go back to chapter 5, and you'll see that when he had his son, he said it made his son in his image, not God's image anymore. Okay, Jenny, could you read Romans 9, 6 through 8?
Romans 9, 6 through 8. That is, though the word of God hath taken none effect, for they are not all Israel which are of Israel. Neither because they are the seed of Abraham are they all children, but in Isaac shall thy seed be called. That is, they which are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God, but the children of the promise are counted for the seed.
Read that last verse one more time.
That is, they which are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God, but the children of the promise are counted for the seed.
Thank you. So here we have a difference in how we are to reckon children of God and not children of God. Those who are of the flesh, these are not children of God. Amen. Now in John 8, we read this in part one. This was Jesus' discourse. I see your hand. This is Jesus' discourse with the scribes and Pharisees, and they kept arguing that they were Abraham's seed. And then Jesus said, you are not Abraham's seed, you do the works of your father. And he finally called them children of the devil. And it was not because Satan and his fallen angels came down and had intercourse with their parents. And one of the arguments is that angels sometimes appear as men. And they believe, the people who believe that angels actually had intercourse with women to produce children, think that not only did the angels appear as human beings, but they have all the working anatomy. That they have all the working anatomy, including a reproductive system. It is a different thing to appear as a human being than to actually be one. We have a hand right here, and we have a hand back there.
Yeah, another scripture that I like to use is the one where Jesus said that angels neither marry nor are given in marriage.
Exactly.
Well, that's exactly what they're saying happened, that these angels came down from heaven and actually married humans and then had children. So, that's Jesus' direct words. They don't marry or are given in marriage.
And I usually punctuate it with that. And if you think about this, if they're fallen angels, why are they obeying the law? If they're fallen angels, why are they obeying the law? Why are they marrying women? We're saying that they had the women in intercourse and had children, but why are they obeying the law by getting married to them? They're angels. They're going to get married to them and go live in a house? What does this mean, that angels are going to marry earthly women? Even if they could do what they're saying they're doing, why are they going to actually get married and obey the law if they're fallen angels?
Here in Hebrews 2, starting at verse 14, it says, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, He also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy them, him that had the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver them through who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. For verily he, Christ, took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. So if these people believe that angels came and had intercourse with women, they're excluded from Christ's sacrifice.
Well, yeah, they believe that. They do believe that.
So then they'd be lost. There'd be no hope for any of them.
They believe that. That's actually what they believe. I'll take one more and then we have to move on because I don't want to run out of time on this topic.
In John chapter 1, we read also, but as many as received him, that's Christ, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believed on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God.
Amen. And actually that scripture is right there on the screen. All right, so let's see. Brother Daniel, could you get Galatians 4:6? I'm going to run through the rest of these. 1 John chapter 3, verse 1 and 2 says, behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world knew us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And when you go down to verse 9, it says, he that is born of God doth not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin because he is born of God. In this the children of God are manifest, and the children of the devil. He that doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. Amen? So those who do not righteousness are not the sons of God. So why would God call angels who fell his son or his sons? All right, now read Galatians. Oh, excuse me. He just read John 1:12. As many as believed on him, to them may he be power to become the sons of God. And Acts 1:8 says, you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you. The same thing that was said to Mary in order for Christ to be born through her and be called the sons of God. Read Galatians 4:6.
All right, Galatians 4:6. And because ye are sons, God hath sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father.
All right. You see the Spirit. Because you are sons, God has given you his Spirit. And Romans 8:14 says, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Sons of God. So the next two words is sons and God. Now, somebody read for me. Euclid, could you read Genesis 6:3?
Genesis 6:3 says, and the Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh. Yet this day shall be 120 years.
Now, we just read that those who were led by the Spirit of God are called what? The sons of God. In verse 3, what do we read God saying? Verse 3 of Genesis 6, what did he say? My spirit shall not always strive with who? Man. So if these are angels who are the wicked ones coming after the women of the earth, why is he withdrawing his spirit from man? If angels are the culprit. You understand in verse 2, he's saying the sons of God, those who had my spirit, saw the daughters of men, those who were living according to the flesh, and they begin to intermingle, and because of that, my spirit shall not long strive with them. You understand that God is saying that those who had my spirit and who would now be considered my sons begin to look at the women who were in the flesh and to lust after them. Now, Euclid, read verses 4 and 5.
There were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bore children to them, the same came mighty men which were of old mean and renown. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually.
Amen. Now, if you look at the title of this slide, I called it hybrid seeds. Because you had the seed of God, and you had the seed of the serpent, and then they begin to hybridize and create new children. But remember, Genesis 6 is really a continuation of Genesis chapter 4. What mechanisms would have drawn these sons of God to the daughters of men? Do you think the things that God listed were just listed arbitrarily? Or did they have some degree of an effect of why they were drawn to the daughters of men? What was one of the major things that they invented that we might have been attracted to? Music. The instruments. And what was one of the instruments' name? Harp and the organ. Now imagine never having heard a harp before in your life. And you hear this music coming from the camp of these who have been separated from you. And you go start to look to see where this sound is coming from. Now remember when Adam and Eve sinned, what type of garments did God give them? Coats. But what type of garments did they put on themselves at first? Aprons. Now when there's music going on, what happens? You don't always take off your clothes, but dancing, right? Now do you think that the daughters of men were actually practicing the same dress reform that God might have given Adam and Eve? So what would happen when the sons of God investigating this beautiful sound come and see these women in aprons dancing around? Remember, Satan was just learning how to tempt and draw man. Remember in Revelation 12, it said his tail drew a third part of the stars of heaven. He learned how to draw them with lies in heaven, but this was a new battleground. And from the beginning, his seed had the use of instruments. And that's why they're so much better at using it even today. It is music, and music, as I said, is the beginning of entertainment, because then it becomes theater when people start to dance to it. And then after a while, you start to get the mechanisms to record it so they don't have to be there in person. Go ahead.
That's the same exact thing that happened on the banks of Jordan. Satan brought in music, tempted the Israelites, and then he brought in the Moabite women, which caused them not to enter into the kingdom of heaven.
As I said, after the flood, it was perfected. What we're seeing in Genesis is the very beginning of his methods. And even in the church right now, movies and entertainment is one of the greatest things that's drawing people away from God. And as I studied more and more, I realized that you cannot preach this last message without talking about media and entertainment, because it is the power of the false prophet. It talks about how the false prophet gets the whole world. He actually does it through media and entertainment. You cannot talk about the false prophet without talking about the power that he's using to draw everybody away from God and to worship the first beast. It is actually being done through entertainment. All right? Genesis 4 and 5, we just read. Matthew 24, most of you can probably quote it. As it was in the days of Noah, so shall it also be at the coming of the Son of Man. Now, I have a question here. Why does God allow this state of corruption to continue so long unchecked if it ends with even good seed becoming contaminated? We have a hand here. Because this was my question, how I really started to do this study. Go ahead.
First of all, it's not unchecked, because God is always ultimately in control. Satan has to get permission before he does anything. Mm-hmm. We can learn that from Job. He could have just wiped Job out immediately, but God said no. And God put like a border around him. And then secondly, God has to allow sin to develop, to bear fruit. It's like the righteous is supposed to bear fruit. Sin has to bear fruit so everybody sees what it really is, what it looks like.
Amen. We have a hand back here, and then we have one over here and one back there.
I was just going to say basically the same thing that was already shared. It just needs to fully develop so that a judgment, when God brings his judgment, he will be vindicated.
Amen. Mm-hmm. We have a hand over here, and then we have one back here on this side. Go ahead.
Yeah, the fully developed character of the person will be seen. That's why he didn't execute judgment on Lucifer from the very get-go. Is that he let it play out so that the fullness of his character will be truly seen. Because everything Lucifer did before was on the radar. Now is carrying out, as seen in the cross. What we saw Lucifer played out at Calvary and the treatment of Christ, the Son of God, is the full extent of what sin is.
Okay. I'll take one more and then I have to move on.
Yeah, I think the word we're looking for is probably loyalty. You started the presentation by saying that the biggest battle we fight is against self. And all of this contamination gives us an opportunity to lay down our will next to the will of God and to submit ourselves unto him.
And that's more the answer I was looking for. All those answers were right. But the part I was looking at, unchecked, if it ends with even good seed becoming contaminated. Why not check it before good seed becomes contaminated? Now, somebody define mercury for me. Because the subtitle to this was Mercury Rising. Whatever definition you want to give me. Okay, it's a metal, it's an element. Amen. Anything else? That's good. That's good enough. Behind you. Mercury is a Roman god. It's also a planet. It's also a planet. Let me just give you a little background of why I call this Mercury Rising. Maybe about 3 or 4 Sabbaths ago, my wife and my nephew and Akilah were about to have worship on Friday night. And I had just been studying, not really studying, but researching the homosexual agenda and its spread and so on and so forth. And that question was in my mind, like, Lord, why does these things have to go on so long unchecked? And the Lord gave me an answer that I kind of knew, but it gives a chance for everybody's character to be revealed. You know, a lot of people won't do something if it's not socially acceptable. But if it becomes socially acceptable, then a lot of people will start to change how they speak about it and how they feel about it. And so a lot of times, corruption actually doesn't contaminate the righteous. It brings to the surface what was already there. It's not that they're being contaminated. I can't take any more because I'm going to run out of time and have to do this.
It's toxic.
Say what?
It's toxic.
It's toxic. Very good point. Very good point. But after that conversation, I came out and I shared that with them. And afterwards, I continued reading this book that I was reading, and the man went into using mercury in an object lesson that gave the exact same understanding that God had given me. And I'm going to read you a few paragraphs from that book. Next word is Noah. All right? This is just from Wikipedia. It says, the symbol HG that mercury is known by comes from its Greek name, hydrargyrum, which means liquid silver to reflect its shiny surface. The element is also known as quicksilver for its mobility. Named after the fastest moving planet in the solar system, mercury has been known to humanity for ages. So if you look it up, it's going to tell you that mercury is named after the planet Mercury. It says, the Romans knew of seven bright objects in the sky, the sun, the moon, and the five brightest planets. They named them after their most important gods. Because Mercury was the fastest planet, as it moved around the sun, it was named after the Roman messenger god Mercury. So both the planet and the element gets its name from where? The Roman god. Mercury is a very interesting god. Element and planet are the next two words. Now, this is a quote from the book. Mercury was the Roman god of commerce, eloquence, travelers, communication, and messengers. And what? Trickery. He was also what? The guide who escorted people into the, what is the underworld? Hades, or what we would call hell, being lost. Mercury escorted souls to being lost. Huh? Yeah, because the occult is just a gateway to the same thing. Mercury is a celebrated god of commerce. The metal most essential to commercial fluidity is named for him. It is Mercury's unique chemical nature that produces what? It produces what? Now, what does refined gold actually represent spiritually? Purity of character. So it was said that it was toxic. But in the natural world, mercury is used to produce refined gold, the fundamental substance in which commercial value is dominated. Liquid at room temperature, mercury draws impurities out of gold ore and binds them into an amalgam. When the amalgam is what? Heated, the heat drives away both the mercury and the impurities. What is left is pure gold. Just as mercury, the metal, draws out impurities and binds them into a mass that is burned and discarded, Mercury, the deity, uses his intellectual brilliance to play Pied Piper to impure humanity. The function of Mercury is a natural process known to pagan and biblical scriptures alike, a process by which impure humanity is attracted to oblivion, leaving behind only the pure. Are you starting to get the picture? God allows sin to continue and to spread because it draws out, even amongst those who appear to be pure, the impure. And then everything is bound together. And then what has to be applied to make the separation? Heat. He attracts followers and leads their soul to Hades, for which the Greeks gave him the title Psychopompus, from psycho soul and pompous director. Because Hades is not the most desirable of destinations, the psychopomp had to construct elegant missionary adaptations. He had to charm souls, deceive them into following him in any way he could, whether by words or what? And sounds. That's your entertainment industry. Like HG, his metallic form, Mercury could change his shape instantaneously. Satan is transformed into what? An angel of light. Did you see the villain in the movie Terminator 2? With his ever-changing voices, physiognomies, and identities, he is a state-of-the-art psychopomp or actor. In many cultures, Mercury's ingenious deceptions earned him the title of the trickster. He was patron deity of deceivers and of thieves. Now, who is the deceiver and the thief in the Bible? Satan. Mercury is really Satan. And he uses all these different things to attract souls and bind them and send them or lead them to hell. Next word is trickster. Trickster. Ezekiel 28 is just talking about Satan and his merchandise and so on and so forth, because it said that Mercury, the god, was the god of commerce. And when you read in Ezekiel 28, it keeps talking about his merchandise and his traffic. and how he moves it. Why is the spread of corruption in our day so rapid as it was in Noah's day? Hebrews 11, 24 and 26. Who hasn't read? Pastor Byers, right here. We got a mic right here. Pastor Byers, could you read Hebrews 11, 24 and 26?
By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasure in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of reward.
What does these verses teach us about sin? Say what? There is pleasure in sin. And we know the verses from 2 Timothy 3 that people will become lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. Now, Ecclesiastes 8:11. Dan, could you read that for me really quick? Ecclesiastes 8:11.
It reads, "There is no man that hath power over the spirit to retain the spirit."
No. Ecclesiastes 8:11.
Sorry. This is how it reads. Because sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily, therefore the heart of the sons of men is fully set in them to do evil.
You see what happens when God doesn't check evil? What happens?
It's fully set.
Those who will commit sin feel more comfortable in doing it. It brings to the surface everything that is in you, and whether you are really God's or not will be tested. Whether you are doing it because there's a punishment or you're doing it because you really do love God, talking about your dedication to God, your motive is going to be revealed. And God will allow sin to go on as long as it needs to for everybody's character to be revealed, because he is not worried about those who are going to cling to him. Understand what I'm saying? He is not worried about losing good seed, because under no circumstances will they break their allegiance to God. And that is actually the example and character of Christ that we saw to the cross, even unto death. Death before dishonor. Amen? We'll read. Turn to Romans chapter 1. We won't read both of these. Romans chapter 1. Verses 28 Starting at verse 28, it says, "And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who, knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them." And you see what's happening with the homosexual agenda? You don't have to participate. Just consent. Just consent to it. Satan is very wise in what he's doing today. And we're going to be persecuted if you stand for God. All who live godly in Christ will suffer persecution. All. It says, though the mythical god Mercury was noted earlier in the study for commerce, eloquence, and trickery and deceit by using sights and sounds to draw souls to hell, Mercury is most famous for the speed in which he moves. And we're told by the spirit of prophecy, the final movements will be rapid ones. Mercury rising. The rapid progress of the homosexual agenda that has drawn worldwide attention and acceptance from many sympathizers through a strategy I'll call victim marketing. That's not really my phrase. Has anybody ever heard of a book, After the Ball? After the Ball. It was written in 1989. It outlines the plan to get America to accept homosexuality. Exactly how they did it. Exactly how they did it. I couldn't believe it as I was turning the pages. They planned it and they executed it flawlessly. Flawlessly. And this was going to be the means to make them be victims and play on people's emotions. And then those who did not once condone homosexuality would come to our rescue just to keep us from being ill-treated. I can't even go into the details of how they said they were going to do it. These were two Harvard graduates who laid out this plan for how it was going to be done. And they executed it flawlessly using the media. That was the whole thing. Television shows, sitcoms, and so on, such the like. They actually call the sitcoms the Trojan horse by which we will get into the houses of those who don't accept us, through putting characters in the shows that were very likable. Very likable. Mercury Rising. All right? Is only a sign that the kingdom of Mercury, Antichrist, is rising to world dominance, and he has done it. Mercury as an element is a deadly substance, and there is also a satanic element at work which is far more deadly. As mercury is combined with gold as a part of the purification process, so has this satanic element combined itself with the faith of Christ. What causes mercury to rise in a thermometer? Heat. But what does heat actually represent spiritually? As in purification of gold, mercury must be heated up to draw out the impurities, leaving behind the pure gold, so shall the fires of trials and persecution separate the impure, leaving behind only those with pure faith. And that's where we're headed. But we have to overcome sin before that time. And the thing is, the hate laws are already there. The hate laws are already there. Everything is in place for things to change in a heartbeat. And we have to be ready before that time comes. Real quick.
Yes. If you look at the law that was just passed, which is the gay rights law, it is a twin institution. And by law and decree, the saints are separated. Now the next one is going to come is the Sunday law. And as soon as it is by decree, then God's people will be separated. Then you will see the wheat and the tears. Because after that, that's it. It's done.
That's the final one. But this one is already separated. This is already separated. If you've already started to close your mouth, you can know what's going to happen when the Sunday law calls. You're not going to open your mouth on that and not open your mouth on this one. A part of the strategy was to silence those who would speak against it. It's in the book. That was part of the strategy, to actually make them be silent. So you may think that you're not condoning it, but you still fell for the plan if you won't open your mouth and say it's wrong. Gold is the next word. All right? How rapidly did mercury or corruption rise after the flood? What happened after the flood? Tower of Babel. Does anybody know how long that took? How long after the flood did that begin? Less than 100 years. Less than 100 years. All right, Genesis 9 is talking about the sons of Noah. And we're not going to have time to really touch upon this. It's not really important to the study, but it does teach us something about Antichrist. As a matter of fact, do you want to hear it?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Okay. We'll go with it. You remember the situation with Noah. He got drunk. And, you know, Ham saw him and his other sons covered him up. Who was cursed after that? Okay. I guess we got to go there and look at it. Because if I say the answer, somebody's going to think I'm wrong because they said something else. So let's go to Genesis chapter 9. So everybody wants to change their answer now? Okay. So who was cursed? Canaan. It was not Ham. Ham did the deed, but the curse fell upon his child. Some people say that's because God had already blessed him and his sons and on the beginning of the chapter. But the curse fell upon Canaan. Upon Canaan. Now, why do I go through this? Has anybody ever tried to preach the gospel in black communities? Can it be rough sometimes? Brother, can you tell me why is it rough? This is going to be a real sensitive topic. It's going to be a very sensitive topic. But why is it rough, brother? Wait for the mic.
It's too colleges of thought. If you deal with black people that have a Christian base, they see Christianity as having a white face because you see a white Jesus, blue eyes, blonde hair. But then if you deal with brothers that have any contact with Islam, oh, forget about it. They don't want no part of Christianity. In addition to the white Jesus that we see, which is unfortunate because it's not accurate, but also from a theological standpoint, there's a major conflict between Islam and Christianity. So if they have any dealings with Islam, it's you got an uphill battle on your hands to even talk to them, let alone, you know, reach them.
Amen. And like I said, this is going to be a sensitive topic because a lot of people don't want to talk about these type of things. But as the body of Christ, if we're truly brothers and sisters, everybody's background and culture needs to be learned, and we need to pray for one another in the giving of the gospel. Because of slavery, many black people don't want nothing to do with Christianity or the Bible, because how it came to them, and the ancestors passed this down, that the slave masters are the reason that we have Christianity. And the story that was given is that, one thing that was taught to the slaves is that you are in slavery and bondage because Ham was cursed. And this is a fulfillment of that prophecy. And because of that, many people want nothing to do with it. Also, the slaves were, this wasn't for the slaves. This was actually for white America who didn't support slavery too much. The story was told that all of Africa is heathen and pagan, and we're doing them a favor by introducing Christianity to them. Through slavery. We're actually going to do them a favor because they're heathen and they eat one another, and Christianity is good for them. But we have to put them in chains because they're savages right now. But over time, this will help them. But I want to ask a question. Dave, announce that at the end, because I'm way past time, and I got a few slides to go through.
As soon as I get the release, come see me, and I'll get you the correct history and all that.
All right. How did Christianity come to Africa? Did it actually come through the slave ships? Adam and Eve. Okay. Let's go to the book of Acts. See, the story was told that Christianity was not in Africa, but that is not true. That is not true. And we're going to actually see why slavery happened, and it was just for the opposite reason. And this still does fit in the context between thy seed and her seed. Because the ultimate fulfillment of thy seed was who? The serpent seed, the ultimate fulfillment was who? The Antichrist, who was who? The papacy. They got their hands in everything. Starting at verse 26. Chapter 8. Starting at verse 26. It says, "And the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip, saying, Arise and go toward the south, unto the way that goeth down to Jerusalem, unto Gaza, which is in the desert. And he arose and went, and behold, a man of what? Ethiopia." Ethiopia means black if you look it up. And he was from Ethiopia. We do know that Ethiopia is in Africa, correct? Okay. "And a eunuch of great authority under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge of all her treasure and had come to Jerusalem for to worship." Drop down to verse 36. "And as they went on their way, they came unto a certain water. And the eunuch said, See, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? And Philip said, If thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And he commanded the chariot to stand still. And they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized them." And so this is how Christianity actually came to Africa in the days of the apostles. It was already there. Now, we're going to read a statement from the Great Controversy talking about the churches that were still in Africa, even 1,000 years after the papacy. The churches of what? Africa held the Sabbath as it was held by the papal church before her complete apostasy. Upon obtaining supreme power, Rome had trampled upon the Sabbath of God to exalt her own. But the churches of what? Africa, hidden for nearly what? 1,000 years, did not share in this apostasy. Whereas it was told Africa was full of paganism and heathenism, it was actually the last place that true Christianity was. After 1,000 years after, let me finish this statement. When brought under the sway of Rome, they were forced to set aside the true and exalt the false Sabbath. But what? No sooner had they regained their what? Independence, than they returned to obedience to the fourth commandment. Now, wait a minute. They regained their independence. When? It had to be shortly after Rome came in. They got rid of Rome. These records of the past clearly reveal what? The enmity, Genesis chapter 3, of Rome toward the true Sabbath and its defenders. Do you know what started the slave trade? Say what? I can't hear you. We're talking about the transatlantic slave trade. You say what? He says Rome, and he's right. You can pull this up online. Romanus Pontifus, Latin for the Roman pontiff, is a papal bull written when? 1454. By Pope Nicholas V to King Alfonso V of Portugal. The two main spearheads in the slave trade were Portugal and Spain. As a follow-up to Dum Diversus, it confirmed to the crown of Portugal dominion over all lands south of Cape Bojota in Africa, along with encouraging seizure of lands and of the Saracen Turks and non-Christians. It repeated the earlier bull's permission for the enslavement of such peoples. This is actually a quote from the bull. "The Roman pontiff, successor of the key bearer of the heavenly kingdom and vicar of Jesus Christ, desiring the salvation of all, wholesomely ordains and disposes upon careful deliberation those things which he sees will be agreeable to the divine majesty, and by which he may bring the sheep entrusted to him by God into a single divine fold. So this is just the Pope saying, announcing his authority and his goodwill towards all humanity and wanting to bring them all into one fold. This, we believe, will be more certainly come to pass through the aid of the Lord if we bestow suitable favors and special graces on those Catholic kings and princes who, like athletes and intrepid champions of the Christian faith, not only restrain the savage excesses of the Saracens and other infidels, enemies of the Christian name, but also for the defense and increase of the faith, vanquish them in their kingdoms and habitations, though situated in the remotest parts unknown to us. Remember, the churches of Africa remain unknown to Rome for almost 1,000 years. And this is what he's talking about, remotest parts unknown to us. Since we had formerly by other letters of ours granted, among other things, free and ample faculty to the aforesaid King Alfonso to invade, search out, capture, vanquish, and subdue all Saracens and pagans whatsoever, and other enemies of Christ, wheresoever placed, and the kingdoms and dominions and possessions, and all movable and immovable goods whatsoever held and possessed by them, and to reduce their persons to perpetual slavery without end, perpetual slavery, and to apply and appropriate to himself and his successors the kingdoms, possessions, and goods, and to convert them to his and their use and profit. And that's how the slave trade started, with a papal bull. And the story that was given to the world is they're all heathen there. But what happened, what was really there, was the Sabbath. Slavery was done to cover up and squash out the last place the Sabbath was. That's the true story. Turn to Revelation 18 real quick. Revelation 18. We're going to look at verses 11, 12, 13, and verse 24. So starting at verse 11. And the merchants of the earth shall weep and mourn over her, for no man buyeth her merchandise anymore. The merchandise of gold and silver and precious stones and of pearls and fine linen and purple and silk and scarlet and all fine and wood and all manner of vessels of ivory and all manner of vessels of precious wood and of brass and of iron and marble, and of cinnamon, and odors, and ointments, and frankincense, and wine, and oil, and fine flour, and wheat, and beasts, and sheep, and horse, and chariots, and slaves, and the souls of men. Verse 24, and in her, this chapter is all about the fall of Babylon and that great city. And in her were found the blood of prophets and saints and all that were slain upon the earth. All roads lead to Rome. Very true. We're just going to touch upon this. This is just talking about the Tower of Babel. We all know this story. And because we're pressed for time, we won't really get into it. But as I said, this happened very quickly. And who was the main antagonist in this story? Anybody know? Nimrod. But it said that somebody went out of Babel and built Nineveh. And that person's name was Asher. Does anybody know who Asher was? No? We'll read this scripture. Turn to Genesis 10. Because this was Mercury rising again. This was Mercury rising again after the flood. All right, let's look at verse 22. The children of who? Elam and who? Asher. He was Shem's son. This was not just Ham's children. Arphaxad is the one who through Christ came. But Arphaxad was not the first one born. Asher and Elam were born before he was. In chapter 10, you actually get the chronology of the births. In chapter 11, you get the genealogy of Christ. When the Mercury rose under Nimrod, it drew Asher into it. So much so that he left Babel and established Nineveh and two or three other cities, totally sold out to the dark side. So when the Mercury rises, anybody can be drawn in, anybody. I asked this question, what was significant about Peleg? Anybody ever heard of Peleg? He was the son of Eber. What did you say, brother? His name means divided. Eber, one of the sons of Shem, but Eber was his father. He was named after the separation that happened in the tower, at the Tower of Babel. In chapter 11, you actually get the numbers of the years of the births. When you add it up, 101 years, and God came down to divide the languages and to destroy the Tower of Babel, which means they had gotten to a lofty height even by 101 years. Very quickly after the flood, did sin start to rise again. Go out and plow your field today and see what comes up first, good seed or bad seed, and see how quick it comes up. Less than 100 years, they had already started this. By 101 years, they had got so far in doing it, God said, I have to come and check it. 101 years, that's all it took. We're not going to go through this. You can study this on your own, though. Genesis chapter 10 is another interlude. It's just giving you all the different people. And you keep hearing a repetitive phrase in chapter 10, after their tongues, after their languages, and so on and so forth. But the first verse of Genesis chapter 11 says they were all of one speech. So Genesis chapter 10 is actually going to show you who was involved in the Tower of Babel. But it's an interlude. I ask this question. How did the goal of the Tower of Babel to reach heaven parallel with the offering of Cain? How did it parallel? Say what? Okay, disobedience. You need that mic. We have Akilah's hands first. Let me go here. We're out of time. I'll take hers and one more, and then we're going to close up. And when you say old merits, what do you mean?
By their own works.
Thank you. The offering that Cain gave was actually what his hands had done. In the Tower of Babel, they were trying to reach heaven by the works of their own hands. It was the same exact spirit. And the thing is, God wanted Cain to offer, and he would accept him. The thing is, God wanted the builders of the Tower of Babel actually to reach heaven. He did, but they sought it by their own works. In contrast, we see, and we're not going to go to the scriptures, what is this a picture of? Does anybody know? Jacob's ladder. The base was on earth, and it reached up to the heavens. It was showing mankind how to truly reach earth from heaven. And what does this ladder represent? Christ. The same with Abel's offering. It represented Christ. Amen? Sorry we didn't have time to elaborate on that, but we're way past the time. The last word is ladder. Ladder. And that's the complete word search puzzle. Brothers and sisters, I'm sorry I took longer than I wanted to, but you're welcome. I really pray that we do more touching upon those sensitive subjects, though. Because as I read in the beginning, the Lord has given us truth so clear that we can stand up anywhere and let truth bear away the victory. And as I said, in the black community, most people don't know that Christianity was there before anybody else came. They don't know that that was the last place that true Christianity was, and that the papacy was chased out, and to get back at them, he released the bulls. The same with every war that came after, with Hitler, and you read about the Jews who had the Holocaust, but also in Germany, the Lutherans were also slaughtered. So under the cover of a lot of different things, the enemies of Rome get wiped out. And so through slavery, the last remnant of the Sabbath was to be squashed out. Did they get some heathens? I'm sure they did. I'm sure they did. I'm sure there was pagans, heathens, Muslims, and all types of religious beliefs in Africa, but the main thrust was we have to get rid of the law of God. That was Satan's plan. Amen? And so I just appeal to us all to get our house in order, because persecution is knocking on our door. Even when this goes out, you know, Advent Hope may get some calls from somewhere saying that we can't be so vocal about certain topics. We haven't gotten there yet, but homosexuality, according to the Bible, is still wrong. A person has free will. They have a right to do what they want to do, and we have no right to do violence unto anyone, but at the same time, we have a right to say what is right and what is wrong according to our conscience. And we must not be silenced, because if we're silenced on this issue, you're going to be silent on the next issue, because the same penalties are going to be in place, the same ones. So if you want God to renew your heart and prepare you to stand, so when he comes, you go the way of the gold and not the way of the mercury, please rise to your feet. Heavenly Father, Lord, we do thank you for being with us. I pray, Lord, that these words will not fall upon deaf ears or hard hearts. We do pray that your angels and your Holy Spirit will be with us to continue, Lord, to bring this seed to fruition. We desire to be good seed, Lord, but we are not born as good seed. As David said, we are born in sin and shaped in iniquity. And without your grace, we cannot be converted and changed and remain in that state. And so, Lord, please purify us and let us be as the refined gold, Lord, and not fall for Satan's devices. We know that this process must go on, but you are long-suffering, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And so I pray for each and every soul that is under the sound of my voice, the households that are represented, and the different people that you will use each one of us to reach. Please give us a greater and deeper and clearer revelation of your love, that we may give you a deeper commitment and consecration as days go on. And if there is anything, Lord, that we've neglected to ask through all these prayers, we do pray that you will grant. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.